MassBio was founded in 1985 by six pioneering companies here in Cambridge who are facing two major hurdles. A lack of understanding and deep worry by the local government about what biotech companies were doing, and the high cost of supplies necessary to do their business. Their formation of MassBio successfully solved these two issues. They created the first ever purchasing consortium for biotech companies, one that now is the biggest in the country, and they educated Cambridge Mayor and City Council about genetic engineering. I'm proud and thrilled to welcome some of the original MassBio founders to the stage. They're going to share their perspective on the industry now and how it's changed in the 33 years since the launch of MassBio. I'm supposed to turn it over to Sue Wyndham Bannister right now, who is the founding CEO of the Massachusetts Life Science Center, who is prepared to be the moderator today. She's running a little behind. I'm hoping that she can join us for the panel. But because these folks are so innovative, they decided that they can moderate themselves as they go. It's called audacity. So now I'd like to hand it off. Why don't we hand it off to you, and Mark, do you want to get started?
Good morning, everyone. Wonderful video, and for those of us who were here in the early 1980s, an amazing video. The industry clearly has come a remarkably long way, but if you really want to understand how much has changed, you have to go back to the late 1970s and early 1980s, when the science was just taking off, and the first companies were being started, and everybody was scared out of their mind. Technology in the 1970s was not a nice word, it was an evil word. Three Mile Island, Silent Spring by Richard Carson, new technology had unintended effects and they were always bad. And along came genetic engineering, and when the universities first started to undertake research, it was viewed not with great suspicion, but with terror. In fact, I remember the city council meeting in which Mayor Bellucci talked seriously about wastewater that would produce a tomato plant that would eat Cambridge, which we thought was a great idea. Because it's been in Cambridge out here, it needed something. So as a result, we were dealing with a huge fear factor, a huge unknown, and the fact that we were really in a world in which everyone viewed us with great suspicion. Four of us, those two others, ended up in a lot of meetings together, city council meetings, other meetings, where we kept having to tell the same story over and over again. So people say, how did the MEC get started? How did MassBio get started? It was basically, we kept running into each other. And the gym officer, we began talking to each other, and because I had the misfortune of having a law degree somewhere in my past, I went, wait, maybe there's something that we can't say to each other, the antitrust rules? And there was a wonderful senior lawyer in town, named Don Evans, a Goodwood Proctor, who said, I have your solution, form a trade association.
So we created a mass market association.
And I would say two last things in a moment. Shut up. But there were two things that really drove us. One was defense. We had to tell, had to educate people. So yes, the Purdue Consortium was a great idea, but it really wasn't the genesis. It was being able to tell the story and being able to educate the public at large. And the second thing was really setting a culture. And I think people ask, what's the success of this industry? It goes back to the very beginning, and even before MassBio, when some of the founding scientists called a moratorium on the research, and then began figuring out some of the ethical issues. And when we started MassBio, we knew that we had to be a different kind of industry. One of our other founders, Peter Feinstein, often said repeatedly, we have to be the industry that wore the white hat, rode the white horse, and stood on the high ground.
So let me tell you one early story from Jen's time, and then we'll give you a flavor, and then let Dana and David add some aspects. So I was hired by the engineer, one of the first hires after he got there, and he agreed with me. He is CFO. But it was very clear when he hired me, he says, you know, I'm in finance, you have an MBA, job for about 3 months, and one Saturday morning I get a phone call at home from the computer management company that's on the 14th floor of Santa Cardinal Street. We were in the middle of the 15th floor of Santa Cardinal Street. And he goes, I have a couple of questions for you. I said, how did you find me at home? He says, that's not a question. He says, what's this red book that's dripping down from my ceiling to my continuously running computers? Is it contagious? And how quickly can you get here to clean it up? So CFO meant food, then the other people assigned. So I called a scientist and I assured him it was not contagious, but we had no clue. This was all coming out of 300 human placentas in the umbilical cord that we were grinding up to extract out the enzyme we need to make glucose of pyruvate. And so I called the scientist and said, it's pretty safe, right? He says, which hose fell off? He says, it's only the process of the problem. Turned out it's a different process, not continuous flowing. So we went over, we cleaned it up, and basically we said we have a good process, we can now take it again.
As Mark said earlier, it was a very eclectic getting together with all these, you know, this monthly crew you see up here. And two of the four of us are coming from the science community. And at that point in time, if you remember back in the early 80s, and if you were in science, the ivory tower was not looking very favorably on doing things outside of getting tenure track positions and doing such and such. And so there was a kind of the culture there was for this very entrepreneurial, you know, the people that got into this, it wasn't even an industry. I mean, I know we spent a lot of time in those early days just trying to decide, what is this? Is it an industry? What's the name of it? And then as all of you know, I think you can do with blockchain right now. You just put blockchain in the name, you're going to get some money. Back then, if you just put cell or bio in your name, you could raise money very quickly. At evaluation, it was predicated by genetic at the time, which was how many PhDs do you have in your ranks. That determined your evaluation by Peter Drake, Vector Securities, and all this history.
Right, 20,000 for PhDs, you just have to hire more people.
You just have to hire more people, yeah, exactly. So you have to remember the time. It was not one where you could easily just jump into the industry. But as Mark said, it was an issue where nobody had any specialty. I'm a marine scientist, an evolutionary biologist. I had no business being in this business from a science standpoint. And they were just willing to take chances at the time because they figured, well, you know, you may have some skill sets you can analyze maybe, so you can maybe get into this. And that's, I'm probably indicative of most of the people that were hanging around at the time. I remember looking in the bio labs and seeing Maniatis and Tashmi and Wally Gilbert and starting these fledgling companies there. And as Mark said, we did not want to have a witch hunt to get into these companies as they were marching through building. And so we said, we're not going to be able to do this on an ad hoc basis. We need to form an association. Many of you remember at the time that there were bios and bio. There were two trade associations. One was called ABC and one was called IBA. IBA had more of the larger companies like Genentech and Hybertech and Cetus in there at the time. And ABC had all the smaller companies, the fledgling ones coming up. And we, at one point, got into real hot water because we were gaining more momentum with our little incorporated group here at the NBC that the national groups started coming down on us and said, well, you're going to have to be a part of us because you're taking all of the funding away from the national scene. And that eventually ended up being, as you know, bio.
So I have a similar background to David. I'm credited this in a similar way. I make this observation a lot, that it was a time when there was no established pool of talent as there is now, or even as was 20 years ago, where you need something done, you find somebody from the pharma industry who did that job and you hire them. The company that I was in, Biotechnica, unfortunately didn't survive the 1980s, but it was one of the early companies she became, and I was actually the first employee he found was brought in, and just as things needed to get done, they said, they wanted to do this, why don't we do that? And that's how I wound up with no legal training, although I do have a scientific background, taking on a company's patent program and research.
Yes.
So I'd like to contrast that time, contrast it to now, because it really is so different. Someone with my background the skills that I had 30 years ago would never be given the responsibilities that I was given in today's environment. So I don't know if this is the appropriate time to move this over a little bit, but you know, because I came from the regulatory perspective, in fact, I was the company's first safety officer, I was probably involved in more of the early discussions that later evolved into the discussions that became the Mass Biotech Council. And there were a couple of developments early on, particularly in Cambridge, although I also recall something that the MWRA was doing, where they were trying to fiddle with the sewer regulations, because they didn't know what we were putting down the sewers and the sinks in our labs. They were trying to change the regulations to make it harder for us to do that, or inactivated microorganisms down the drain. So it was primarily the three largest companies at that point in Cambridge. It was our company, Biogen and Genetics Institute, where the safety officers began, like Mark said, to see each other at the same meetings, to get to know each other, to get to work together on some of these issues. And then that later became the nucleus for the meeting that Mark was talking about, where senior attorney Don Evans pulled together a larger group of us when there was some federal regulatory developments that were going on that at the time at least threatened to impose a tougher regulatory regime that ultimately emerged from the Reagan administration. So that's really how things started.
But the whole issue of how we enact regulations really falls through the how the industry today works with all the regulatory markets. If you think back to some of the industries in the 70s, many of those industries had an adversarial relationship with the regulators. We took a different approach, and I think this is one of the hallmarks of this industry, is that our belief was if we had good science-based regulations, research all the way through product approval, it would engender public confidence. And so we were known as the first industry to be pro-regulation. And one of the great myths is, oh, Cambridge became the mecca because of its proximity to Harvard and MIT. Not even close. Cambridge had two things going for it. First, there was a vast wasteland here which was really cheap to rent and had unlimited food parking. It did not cost $20 an hour. The second thing was Cambridge was the first community to put in regulations, but they thought they were going to be doing us a disservice. They said, we're going to put in the most onerous regulations there are, they're the ones that the NIH has to govern laboratories, and you're going to have to be governed by the same regulations. And we went, yes! That is great, let's go there. Because they were predictable, they were science-driven, you knew what to do, and that's why, you know, GI, which I was first hired, was over at the Lyman Hospital building that was abandoned when they did the mergers into Brigham and Women. And you know, my first office was the delivery room, by the way. But that's why we moved to Cambridge, because we knew we would have the ability to do research and do it in a way that we didn't have to worry about regulation. We could have all the other stuff to worry about, but that wasn't one of them.
One of the Cambridge ordinance that was responsible for my getting a job, my first responsibility was to write the permit application for the Cambridge
Commons. So if I believe what people were saying yesterday, this industry now is all visionary people that are just executing those plans. And if you read the Harvard Business School case studies on Genzyme, they did a series of cases which basically an engineer comes up with this great vision and just executes his job. I have all the business plans. I'll give you one example because in science I don't think it works that way. So we had been working for a number of years on developing glucosidic peptides to treat Gaucher's disease. And we were getting permission from the FDA to take it into phase 1 clinical trials, which as most of you know, you usually go and help people in a small number to just see if you do any harm. But the head of the National Organization of Rare Diseases was an Eastern European Jewish descent, and her oldest son, Brian, was dying. And it was going to be too long to get through the FDA process because Brian would be dead before, and it was a nasty death, so he basically lose one organ after another, and eventually died. So she asked us if we would, we got a call from someone at the NIH and said, she asked us if we'd make Brian the first patient we treated. So we gathered up 300% of this in milliliters, ground them all up, stored them down carefully in the freezer, so we had a big enough batch that we could treat Brian and see if it would actually work. The weekend before Brian's supposed to be treated, there's a power outage in Chinatown. All the buildings go black. We had a backup generator. The backup generator didn't kick in. So the scientist comes in Sunday morning and discovers that the frozen enzyme now has gone up above freezing. And we're really not quite sure at those days how the sugar structures on the enzymes work. And so he just freezes it back down and hopes for the best. A couple of days later, he flies down to Washington, D.C. and treats Brian. Miracle cure. It clears the limits of his system. We go, okay, now we can celebrate. We've got a human proof this works and no side effects. The next three patients that we treated over the next coming weeks, no impact whatsoever. It was a completely useless technology. And I've been told by anyone who comes out of Big Pharma, okay, if you do three or four patients and it didn't work, but three out of four, you don't bother to go, especially with an orphan disease, there's only 5,000 people known who have the disease, you just abandon it. Instead, because of the culture that Henry created at Genzyme, the chief scientist who had that experience went back into the lab and said, there's got to be something that happens when you take it from below freezing, above freezing, and put it back down to below freezing. That turns out the carbohydrates, the sugar structure, we had cleaned off two of the sugars and had the one now exposed and takes it up in the hepatocytes. So not only did we have a basis for a good therapy with the next three patients, we did it all work wonderfully again, but we became now the world's leaders on carbohydrate modeling. It didn't exist until we figured out what happens to sugar structures. That became Genzyme to be part of the billion-dollar product.
So a lot of the other companies that were coming up during that period of time, as I said, you know, you could raise money like you can today in the same way. I mean, now it's much more difficult. But in those days, it was relatively easy to get VC money, as long as, like I said, you put a bio or a gene in your name, and you could do that. But along with that came a lot of, I think, flagrant spending and things. And we've kind of agreed up here that we're not going to share a lot of stories because we can still incriminate us. Because I think some of the players are still alive. But there are some stories that kind of indicate kind of what was going on there. And the first company I was with, Damon Biotech, which is a monoclonal antibody production company out of MIT technology, we had actually purchased a cast of stock as part of our assets. And that was, the person who was supposed to run it sees himself in the Boston Globe science section getting killed, which he'd done. But he didn't know that we had purchased a castle with a bar as well, and a Mercedes station wagon to transport everybody to the castle. So there are stories like that of, you know, why do you have a two-seat Mercedes as your company car, and, you know, $15,000 the car is doing it now, it's $31,000 diamond, but $15,000 for a desk for the CEO. I mean, there were things like that going on there. So, you know, there's good with the bad. And the other thing I was going to mention is that this industry started on the two technologies, genetic engineering, gene splicing, and monoclonal antibodies, pretty much. And probably two of the major groups that spawned a lot of these came out of either the Baxter Mafia, which we call them, or the the Waters Millipore group as well. And that spun out a lot of, as most of you know, a lot of other companies. And it continues to this day. Vertex spinning off a bunch of other ones with Concert, so there's all of these. And so it's a really, over this 30-year period, it's a very helpful community. It's not a backbiting community in general. If you need another lab bench, you just call, you know, the CEO of the next company and say, yeah, sure, we got some lab benches you can use. So it's a very constructive community that you're all a part of, and that's the nice thing about this business.
I think that was also, again, we were fortunate because we had no idea what we were doing. It was basically, what kind of group did we want to hang out with? And we liked each other. And we were willing to help each other. And that became the culture. And we look around the industry today, what's great is that culture that was sort of spontaneously spawned has continued today. This is an industry where you see more social gatherings, more interaction, a recognition that yes, you're competitors, but you're not cutthroat competitors. You're there to sort of advance the science and as well as advance your own products. That started really by accident, but it started because we liked each other. We liked hanging out with each other. The fact that, to think that this is our first gathering without Scotch is really disappointing about it.
But I will violate Dana's rule because Kennedy shared a story from the early days was one of something about Genzyme Gene. So when the company was started, the goal of the biotech was to get people to know who you were. And it's really hot that you're doing research in a lab and there's nothing that really is newsworthy, and yet you need to raise money so you have to recognize the name. So the chairman of the board decided the best thing, he was at the Newmont races in England, watching the races, and he goes, if I had a horse named Genzyme Gene, this would solve my problems. So he bought the race horse that won that, put it on the books as the training expense and the bus and the fee as marketing expense. The team perfectly legitimate to him. When I get hired as CFO, and I have to meet my auditors. We try to clean the books up to go public. I think we're going to have a chairman buy back to Genzyme Gene. But for about 12 months, we had a race horse in England that was got a very much higher profile than any other video in the industry.
Are there questions out there? Because we could go on for hours. Not we move
on. One more story, just to give you sort of a flavor of what it was like to join these very little companies, because we were all among the first few employees. Henry hired me. I was at a banking company as a strategy consultant in Europe. I had spent most of my time in London. So he hired me because he had, you know, now become president and had these operations in England, and this is actually where we financed everything. So I told him I was out on February 13th of 1984. 12 to a week ahead, and he goes, you're starting on Monday. I said, yes, Henry, don't worry, I'm starting on Monday. He says, you still in London? I said, yes. He says, can you start in London? So yeah, I'll fly to London on Monday. He says, no, you're going to fly on Sunday. Because then you meet with our bank manager at 10 a.m. on Monday morning. That would make sense for 10. I said, it makes sense, CFO, I don't know my job. I can go meet bank manager. He says, no, they pulled our line, and I'm going to be technically bankrupt unless you can figure out how to get a stay. I said, okay, I think I can do that. He says, and you've got to pick up the chairman of the board because he's already flown over there for this meeting. So I get out, pick up the chairman of the board, almost kill us both going through a roundabout the wrong way. Drive down based on Kent. Chairman's wearing blue jeans and a bomber jacket. The Maidstone Kent bank manager looked like most bank managers in the 1980s. We wouldn't talk business until we had coffee and cookies. So we had coffee and cookies, and he says, now how are you going to pay off this $1.5 million bank line? The chairman goes, well, not only can we not pay it off, we need more money or you're going to lose it all. At which point I turned to him and I said, Taylor, why don't you keep your coffee and cookies outside? And unfortunately, I had known a number of CEOs in Europe that I had worked for at Bain. And so I said, look, this is my first day of the job. That's my second hour of the job. I can get people out for me. You just need to give me a little bit of time to make this clear. He goes, okay, I'll give you 6 weeks. I never want to hear Genzyme's name again. Fly back to Boston, go meet with Ben in Boston, who was trying to figure out how to get into biotech. And I said, well, if you lend me $2.5 million, you'll not be in biotech, and I'll go pay off this line. He said, well, that's good, then no collateral. I said, well, how do I get the venture capitalists to give us a B round? And we raised another $2.5 million from the venture capitalists. He said, oh, well, then you've got great security. I go to the venture capitalists and said, well, we have two choices. We'll be out of business this week, or you can invest another $2.5 million. He said, well, that seems like a good thing to do. After all, the bank will lend you more money than you can't do that better. So we closed simultaneously on our B round and our bank line, and the bank manager then came back to us about 2 years later and said, then we have to get Genzyme's business back.
And we were all asking Jim after that transaction, we're calling and saying, what's a B round? what do we do?
You laugh because in the beginning, there were no B rounds. Yeah. There was a venture capital round. You did some deal with a large farmer, and then you did an IPO. Because you could do an IPO in 3 to 3.5 years from 1979 to 2001. It was a great, there was a cycle. But a lot of this, what you're doing is, we were making it up as we went along. some ways, but I hope for all of you is that you're still having as much fun as you had.
Yeah, I think you're going to notice it. You know, it was the Wild West. We're kind of entrepreneurial guys, and so I know for a fact that all of us, maybe the 11 quite on that, but you know, three of the four of us here became VCs. Two are retired now. This guy's still chugging ahead, holding the torch. But but we all have stories about you know taking it to the line. I know Jim put his house on the line for one of his companies right before the holidays, and I also asked my wife if I could take our retirement money to keep my company going because I knew I was going to get a deal done, but I had to wait, and I didn't want my employees to. They had paper on the streets or probably go to Jim's company. And so I had those things in place. When we would give talks over the years, I remember when I give talks about the bio industry, about the entrepreneurial starting companies, it was always, we were on the pendulum, we were always trying to curry favor with the pharma companies, trying to get the credibility, validation from these guys. Then it kind of evened out. And now, as you know, the pendulum switched now where pharma's now hanging out in Federal Square and things to be closer to where the action is. And I think that when we were nucleating these companies, we were very good at having entrepreneurial talent to staff the R&D. But when we have to hire those downstream infrastructure FTEs, we would be going to the pharma industry. And quite frankly, I know at every company I was with, we always questioned the pharma executives coming in because you know, they're a very different culture, very different mentality, and most of these guys had never, and women, had never had to raise money, okay? So they're very good in their little turfs, but, you know, we're, as Dave said, we're handling everything, you know, and so that was always a question of whether these folks could do the job beyond if they were in a startup, and most of them failed, quite frankly, and that's now not so much an issue now, but it was then.
New England Biolabs, founded in about 1974, and I think of them as kind of seminal to the start of this, but I'd love to hear your perspective on it.
They've been around forever, right? They're still there and still branching out to all different areas. One which is close to me, which is the marine DNA work, which is going to Gloucester now, and I was on the board of the MBL in Woods Hole, and we were trying to figure out how to acquire that collection for the MBL as well. That New England Biolabs has been a kind of a different model, but they've been around for so long as a key piece to the industry, supplying reagents and oligos the whole time to the industry, to the companies.
But they were more a supplier to the industry than part of the industry.
Right, they were a supplier.
That was a distinction that we made early on between the operating companies and the suppliers, or that distinction.
You can tell quickly, they're profitable, they're suppliers.
Right. I'll tell you a story. When I went to my first company, I was in my office at Needham Heights, and I'm sitting with my dad, who had been in the television repair business all his life, so he was always fixing things. And he came into my office feeling very uncomfortable, and he's sitting there in my, you know, kind of these stables type desks, you know, these kind of nothing fancy. And he's looking around at all the books on the shelves, and he goes, "So how do you make money?" And I said, "You don't, because we're all in the red, right?" So I said, "I don't know how to make money."
But the flip side is that you scratch anyone who's in the early days of the industry, this backstory of the reason they were attracted to this high risk, chaotic industry. In my case, I came to Genzyme because that's with Penn and Premier there, it looked like the best kind of startup in New England, and I wanted to live in the Boston area. But I left Genzyme because during the 80s, my dad died of lymphoma, and my brother David died of AIDS. And we didn't have any good disease models to let you develop the therapy, so it was hit or miss, the drug testing and people trying to come up with therapies. And this new technology came out in the late 80s called transgenics. And one of the most interesting groups had been integrated genetics, who decided that it was too far out, so they had let those people go. So I went and took me and six scientists instead of transgenic scientists in Worcester. And then we were going to develop this technology, and I was going to be able to create these disease models.
Well, it turned out integrated genetics was right. It was way longer than what I had patience for to get there. So I went and bought a lab that was doing about $8 million a year in business, doing this pre-testing, figured out now I have revenues, I have offset from my process, we've always done a gen time by having major revenues while developing science. But I had, unfortunately, I had very little money. We run a public and very small public offering, and I'm going to take about $1 million for that. But fortunately, the Mason Labs was owned by a Fortune 500 company who didn't even know that they had it. It was very deep down in their financials. So I met the head of corporate development and said, well, it's probably worth $5 or $6 million, so you have to pay me $7 million to get it taken out of my hands. He said, well, my finance teacher at business school told me that you can do a deal if you can control one of two things. If the seller sets the price, you set the terms. If he sets the terms, you set the price. So he set the price. We said, okay, I'll put up $1 million. You'll take back $3.5 million note, the seller's note, and we'll finance $3.5 million from the local bank based on the assets of the business I'm buying. Seemed like a good deal to me. Unfortunately, as we headed up towards closing on it, the banking situation was deteriorating. So the banker calls me and says, we'll still do the deal, but on the condition you personally co-sign for all of this and turn over the title to your house, because we can't, in the master's law, if you go bankrupt, we can't take the house unless you give us the title first. Well, my wife's a shrewd business person, so she re-underwrote that deal, included it over the weekend, and we were going to make it work. And so she gave it on two commitments. One is that we would fire the bank as soon as I got into this, we would fire the bank and move to somebody else. The other is the house would go into her name after this.
The involvement of the government, obviously you see how much time it takes now and the effort that we put forth to work with both the state and federal government. What was it like back in the mid-80s when you had to really educate local and state government?
It was an extraordinarily difficult proposition. People did not know what we were. We hadn't yet come up with the name biotechnology. The one advantage we had was the governor at the time was Michael Dukakis, who got his start as a town meeting member in Brookline, representing my neighborhood. And so I got to Michael and I said, I need you to come to the first meeting of MassBio, because it will give an imprimatur to the industry and it will show that from the highest levels, this is an important industry. And in turn, I promised him a crowd of 60 people. Now, we only had six companies. So that meant that I had to go around and say, hey, every one of you guys, I need 10 guys or women here at the meeting for 2 hours when the governor shows up.
And at the time, it was about half the company.
It was, and sometimes more. So we packed the room, the industry shut down in the state for the day. But that was a start.
The other person who was critical of the creation of the industry in Massachusetts was Ted Kennedy. That he had used his position in Washington very correctly and pushed through the Orphan Drug Act, which really, certainly Genzyme wouldn't exist if it wasn't for Ted Kennedy's Orphan Drug Act.
And I think that we spent an awful lot of time up on Beacon Hill educating folks, an awful lot of time in communities educating people what we were about, because there was a fear. If Needham had a biotech company next to a school, what did that mean? And so that became a really important part of the industry, and again, part of the culture, where we were the guys who were reaching out. And we were doing it in the beginning, like people who were in the industry, in the lab, every day. So we were living it. And I think that gave comfort to folks on Beacon Hill, because they were dealing with the people who were in the trenches. And that became, I think, an important part of the start of the industry.
People tell us we need to bring the softball league back. Why do they always say that? Do you guys have amazing softball leagues?
Oh, yeah.
And he was the first
to hear it.
I have to mention that. The small group of us that are in the safety office, we also became the softball league commissioners. And that was really one of the genesis of the MassBio. And I think we had 14 or 16 the first season.
I still have the softball the year that we won.
Oh, okay.
But if you want to talk about it.
But if you want to know how wrong we were about the future of the industry, when we started out and did the plan for MassBio, there were six companies in, and our goal was to get to an industry that had 20.
One question. two questions if I can squeak them in. One, is this illustrious history being captured comprehensively and broadly distributed? Like, I read a lot and I don't know where sort of all this is just, oh, cute. Okay, good, I'll get that.
Write Jim's book, it's available on Amazon.
You can give me a free copy after that.
Jim, you brought your publicist.
And second question, just looking at sort of where we are as an industry with the general perception of biotechnology and biopharma, sort of having gone down to the dark side of sort of in the same categories, oil, tobacco, etc. Is it time for the group collectively to think about spawning a whole new industry tagged maybe in the area of digital health? And then if yes, is San Francisco going to be able to take claim to that? Or can Boston Cambridge, under Bob's leadership, of course, really push to put that flag in the ground?
Great question. So
when we came into the industry in the early 80s, San Francisco was way ahead. But Cetus and Genentech had set up a culture that basically you stole each other's people and you put up barriers so that no information could pass. We set up, as Mark was alluding, a very different culture. And as a result, the industry blossomed in a way because people, if someone had a better, would have a higher worth at another company, you would send them with a note that says, with my blessings, they're a very creative person, but you obviously need them. We helped each other as we went along. There's a piece, though, that also seems to get lost. In the midst of the chaos, when we didn't know what to believe, and we were all making up as we went along, there was a way that came out of the Baxter executives, and Henry's career showed it very strongly, that we would never let anything violate our integrity. And we were surrounded by technology companies who were routinely violating integrity. So I remember that first end of the year in 1984, Henry had been promised by the board that they would make him CEO in the following spring if we hit certain numbers, a certain sales level and this profit. And we then got a phone call right after Thanksgiving from the English plant that basically has now been contaminated. So the big order didn't get shipped and we were going to miss the numbers. So Peter Markley walks to my office, tells me this situation. So we're going to talk to Henry, go to Henry's office. And Henry looks at me and goes, well, there's a couple of rules here. One, is you're the financial officer, so you need to make sure we don't violate any rules. There's all kinds of ways you can do this that violate rules, you can't do that. Two, you and David are smart people, you can figure out how to get replace the sales gap. Three, don't do anything that keeps me from being CEO. We pull it off.
Guys, we have time for one more quick question.
Not a question so much as a little advertisement in answer to your question. I represent an organization called the Science History Institute. We are the historians of the biotech and chemical industries. I invite you to look at our website, sciencehistory.org. And you four gentlemen, I don't know for sure if we've done oral history interviews with each of you. If we haven't, we want to. We've done over 180 oral histories with biotech pioneers around the country, and we continue to do that work.
And buy my book, Spiritual Evidence.
Jim, where can we buy the book? It's on
Amazon.
Perfect. And the title is?
Spiritual Audacity.
Spiritual Audacity. How about a big round of applause for our panel? Thank you very much, John.